I'm Ryan Gariepy. I'm the CTO of Clearpath Robotics and Automotors. And today we're talking about robotics and using robotics for good.
Congratulations! You are tuned into Dov Barron's Leadership and Loyalty Show, the number one podcast for Fortune 500 executives and those who are dedicated to creating a quantum leap in leadership. Your host, Dov Barron, is the founder of FullMontyLeadership.com. He's an executive mentor to leaders like you, a contributing writer for Entrepreneur Magazine, CEO World, and he's been featured on CNN, Fox, CBS, and many other notable sites. Dov Barron is an international business speaker who was named by Inc. magazine as one of the top 100 leadership speakers to hire. Now, over to Dov Barron.
Welcome, dear friends, fans, and fellow aficionados of leadership excellence. Thank you for joining us on this episode of Leadership and Loyalty Tips for Executives. I'm Dov Barron. I am the Dragonist, and I'm here to assist you tapping into the one thing in your business that changes everything by transforming meaning into action. Find out more about me, simply go to dovbarron.com. That's dovbarron.com. Let me ask you, in what ways do you need to up-level your leadership? Here's what I mean. When the COVID-19 pandemic hit, one of the things that happened was that much of the resistance we've had to future technology simply went away. People realized that it's time to step into the future that they had been resisting. Are you still resisting what's coming, especially in the world of robotics? Well, we'll find out soon. Stay tuned. Remember, you can chat with us, or you can chat about this episode or any past episode by going to either LinkedIn or Facebook and look for our groups. Just look for the Leadership and Loyalty podcast. If you're a new listener, new viewer, I want to thank you for joining us. Strap yourself in. We're about to go full Monty. And as always, you can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, or wherever you tune into podcasts. We always need your help in staying relevant. So please get over to wherever you go, rate, review, and subscribe to the show. All right. You can also catch us on traditional radio stations across the United States every Monday and Thursday. We're also on Roku TV, where there's over 100,000 subscribers. And with a potential reach of 2.5 to 4 million listeners for every single show, we're honored and grateful to be cited by Inc.com as the number one podcast to make you a better leader. If you listen, you can also listen to us on Google Home or Alexa by simply saying play Dov Barron podcast. Again, I want to thank you for sharing the show with everybody I know. All right, let's strip it down and dive right in. On this episode, Ryan Gariepy, right? Gariepy, yes, is our guest. I saw Ryan speak at Singularity University in April of 2019. I was fascinated by the work that he was doing. You see, he is the co-founder of Clearpath Robotics. He believes in the responsibility of tech companies to use technology for good. Ryan understands that more than most, and the opportunities and the limitations of robotics. So what does robotics for good mean? Is it possible to use it for good and keep it that way? And what does the role of robotics play in the world that we are about to enter into faster than ever? Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and help me welcome Ryan Gariepy! Good to have you here, mate.
That's a great introduction, probably the best one yet.
50,000 people. So before we jump in, one of my favorite questions to ask people is, who might we not know, maybe wouldn't even consider, who has been a major influence on you and on your leadership? Who's been somebody who's really impacted the way that you lead?
I'd say I personally, and this is something I'd say, and probably a lot of people have a similar answer in common, is my family. Mm-hmm. My father, some uncles of mine, my grandfathers, they've all had a significant influence on my leadership, especially because they've been working in industries which are very, very different from the robotic space, very different from the high tech, the tech startup world, but they still have had a great amount of influence on me going forward. I think that's been the first answer that very quickly comes to mind.
What would you say was the major point of their leadership that has hit you, that made you sort of realize, maybe even looking at others and going, I'm so glad I got that from my family?
I think I think when it comes to the points of leadership, one of the first things I remember hearing from, I believe it was my father, was that kind of do what you say you're going to do. If you're going to do something, or if you're going to say that you're going to do something, you should do it. And that really struck home. It was something my parents were really consistent with. And it's all that, you know, it's that big theme. When you read any kind of leadership book, it's all, they're always talking about the importance of doing what you say you're going to do and establishing trust with your team and vetting people for their ability to do so. But it was something I was really seeing at this very young age.
It's very interesting to me because I think that integrity is one of those words that is thrown around. It's in people's mission statement and their vision statement, but rarely is it actually lived. And I'm really glad to hear that that was ingrained into you, because I think we're living in a world where integrity right now, in a level of leadership, is, let's, should we say, sadly lacking. Let's just go with that for now. To be somewhat politically correct, and anybody who knows me and knows the show knows I am far from politically correct. So let's jump in. What, in a big picture level, what is the future of robotics in our everyday lives? Because you're the robotics guy. What's the future of it in our everyday,
But there's, I mean, from my perspective, and there's always many, many visions of robotics. It's been a fixation of popular culture for decades, but from my perspective, it really is about taking the dull, dirty, and dangerous jobs out of people's hands. That phrase itself goes back. That phrase goes back many years. It's many years on its own. But that's where I see the purpose of robotics and where robotics will eventually go. It's about taking care of that lowest level of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. That's really where robotics should be going. And I think we're seeing more and more realization recently after, I'm not even talking about in recent events, because you and I are living through one of the most probably transformational events of living history right now. Mm-hmm. But even over the last several years, we've seen some robotics applications become really interesting, really possible. And then quickly people realize that they're not actually that useful. And I think that over time, some of those applications will come back into vogue, but fundamentally people need to be fed. People need to be housed. People need stuff. Those things are going to get handled more and more by robotics. I think that's not only where we should go, but that's where we need to go.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember the name of the movie. I think it was called Frank, I think. And what it was about a care worker, a medical care worker, no, maybe it wasn't called Frank. The lead actor's name was Frank. Now I just remember his name. But it was a guy who was ill and he was dying, and he lived like in the woods or, you know, in a cabin somewhere. And his primary care worker was a robot, right? And, it was said to be quite futuristic. But then when I did the research on it, it was like robot care workers are not that far away. You know, and today, as you and I record, you know, we've got the pandemic of COVID-19, and robot care workers would be a really good idea for keeping medical professionals safe. And we know that today at 7 p.m. every night during this, people are banging on pots and shouting things out of windows to support medical care workers. Do you see that as something that's really going to move forward fast? Do you think that this is going to push that further forward?
I think I'm actually not as enthusiastic about robot care workers as some are, of being something that we can get in the next 5 or 10 years. Mm-hmm. And there's been a number of people who have talked about what a care worker really is, and particularly from a robotics standpoint, chief among them being Rodney Brooks. And mm-hmm. when you break down what a care worker is, like, there's a lot of complexity in that job. There's a lot of human interaction and a lot of emotional intelligence that goes on and a lot of nuance. But what I might put forward is that a lot of time, or a lot of the reasons right now people are banging on these drums and are trying to support care workers at this time, is also because of what the situation they're being put in. right? They have no PPE. The hospitals are overcrowded. They don't have the equipment they're going to need. They're put in these difficult situations where people might die because they have to triage them. And that's a really hard place to be in. But every one of those challenges can be solved. And every one of those challenges isn't really as much of a human nature problem. They're a problem of purely supply and demand.
Yeah. I think that, you know, you said, what was the term? Dull, dirty, and dangerous jobs. But the economics of that are fascinating to me, because I've had this conversation with many of the leaders I've worked with and interviewed, in that people want to cling to those shitty jobs because maybe they feel like that's all they can do. The economics of it is that that's the only job that they feel qualified for, or where an employer will pay them basic minimum wage, you know. And so, you know, taking coal mining away from coal miners. So I'm old enough that I remember the miners' strikes in the UK in the 70s, right? And I remember those. I was a kid, but I remember them well. And I remember the resistance to the shipyard closures, to all those things, to closing down. I mean, the miners' strike closed the country down. And at the same time, mining has almost disappeared in the UK. I mean, I think you can sort of slow things down. You can have a bit of a process of putting the brakes on, but the future's coming, right? How do we get people to embrace the idea of robotics when they feel like it's their, you know, the jobs that they're doing is their bread and butter? It's as you said, bottom level of the hierarchy. How do I eat?
Well, I think this is the situation that we're all in right now is almost going to be a forcing function to how various countries do choose to react. Right? Like what has been recently announced in Canada is arguably the beginning of a universal basic income policy. It's time limited, but that's effectively what it is. And the question for each country is how they choose to move that forward, because the question which I'd ask, you know, everyone is do people want to work that job really? Like, and what is also, you get into deeper questions like what is the overall load on society of someone who is mining coal for their entire life and then has to be taken care of by the healthcare system, mm-hmm. right? There's all of these interesting questions that need to be asked. And I think the other question is it's almost getting into some abstract thoughts around schooling. Like if on the other hand, you were free and there was less of a cost and less of a social stigma to go back to school after your, hypothetically, your trucking job was displaced by a robot when you're 40 years old, then mm-hmm. maybe there's something that you're better at, right? Maybe to use the cliche, the next Einstein is out there digging a coal mine right now. And of course, I recognize that there will be some people who will still want to, you know, just sit on the couch and play video games for a while. But I've got to believe that that's a relatively small portion. That's a relatively small portion of the world that's out there.
I would agree with you, but I think you've got two ends of that spectrum. And on one end, as I said, is this survival-driven individual who's doing a low-end job that's shit for their health or whatever it might be. And on the other end of that is the, let's just call them hyper-conservative, financially hyper-conservative, who are really about making profit, who say, we don't want to set up a welfare state, you know, and have people staying home and getting $1,000 a month. Like, I don't know anybody who could survive on $1,000 a month, you know, but that's okay, fine. Even in a shitty job, you're getting more than that. So, you know, I mean, it's a very interesting time because, as I said, I think that the pandemic we're in has created a brink that's pushing us forward that we may, I think we would have been Luddites about for another 10 years.
Oh, yeah. No, I agree. And I think you also have to look at one of the thoughts and discussions we've had internally is you have to look at what kind of support people are getting. Right. Non-monetary support, for example. Like if we go back to the Renaissance, Middle Ages, and you wanted to walk around on the street, hypothetically. Mm-hmm. Well, it's you're not safe. The street is mud or worse. There's no fresh water. Yeah, there's no fresh water. There's none of that. So even right now, the experience of walking around on the street in an urban environment is much safer than it was a century ago. Mm-hmm. So if we're saying that maybe it's not a wealth transfer, but maybe there's just somewhere to sleep or eat. Like now, I can go to a public park, or rather, I could go to a public park, you know, barring the last week or so, and I could get free water to drink.
Right.
Free, clean, fresh water. Now, that wasn't always there. So, and I think that's a question that we need to understand too. And I think I generally have faith in the majority of humanity, the large majority of humanity, to want to accomplish things, whether it's out of pure, you know, self-actualization, or frankly, just because of jealousy and greed of who the next person one house over has.
Right. So you were one of the first people to take a stance against outlawing killer robots. That was a fairly bold decision, especially seeing as your company depends on the adaptation of robots. And you do have military work. So talk to us a little bit about taking that stand, particularly when you, I know because we talked about it, you do work for the military.
It's an interesting thing, right? Like if you're in robotics, you can't, in my opinion, you can't swear off contact with the military. I mean, military funding has brought us a GPS. It's brought us the internet. It's brought us a plethora of new things. I mean, if we want to talk about, again, current events, it's brought us the entire concept of triage and intensive care, right? That's a derivation of military, military developments. So it would be very hypocritical to say, I'm not going to do any work from the military. But on the other hand, we need to look and say what work is useful, and also fundamentally, where might policymakers or the like not fully understand the situation and the risks. And when I look at the autonomous weapons systems challenge, I look and say that first, it's a very difficult situation to assess, right? Like these vehicles, these agents that people are talking about developing are not going to be that risk-free. They're going to fail in unique and unpredictable ways. And then on top of it, we also need to look at, if we're going to spend all of this money as society onto the military, let's look at encouraging dual use technology, right? Like if we look at search and rescue military technology for reconnaissance, that can turn into search and rescue technology. And from there, it can turn into like camera drones, like for filmmaking and for entertainment, right? Like there's a very clear progression from some basic military piece of technology to something that's generally useful to everyone. But on the other hand, something that's good for like assessing should something be killed or not, there's not that much ancillary benefit to society coming out the other side.
But at a simple level, do you have any control of that whatsoever? I mean, if you sign
personally?
I think that if you sign on a contract with to build a robot for the military, you may hope that the evolution of that process is, you know, a drone that we use to take these really cool shots of weddings was originally, used to drop bombs on people. I mean, I love drone photography, don't get me wrong, but it's, there's a moral and maybe ethical line, and I don't know where it is. I'm not pretending I do, because I understand that everything has come from a technology, and that technology is often used in ways that were less than ethical initially. So how much input do you actually, in a real world sense, get?
Yeah, well, that's of course a challenge. And I think, fundamentally, when you're working for the military doesn't actually build anything and design anything themselves.
No.
You know, they work for defense contractors. So in the end, one of the reasons we did put our voice out there is that if the military or a military tier one defense contractor, whose names are all familiar to probably the vast majority of the audience,
sure,
if they're contracting, a group like ourselves, they're pretty much going to know where we stand on this issue. Mm-hmm. So if they have any thought mentally that down the line they're going to want to add this functionality, they know that maybe we're not the right people to engage with up front. But also, but as you say, it's a very challenging situation. And that's the reason we wanted to put it in the public eye, because much like other technology out there, once you get that very clear public norm established, or you know, various sorts of regulations, whether nations sign on or don't sign on for a variety of political reasons, you still get them established. And then it's, there still is inertia, right? Like there's, without getting too far down the weapons control aspect of this interview, because I think we had other topics, you can look and talk about how, you know, landmine bans, there's a number of nations haven't signed on to landmine bans. But on the other hand, they're still not really making them. So arguably, the process worked.
Yeah, it's, I mean, we're off on a bent that could go into a very fascinating ethical conversation, you know, which I think is interesting.
Next time.
Right. Oh, well, I find it fascinating and interesting because we don't know where the line is. You know, we're all familiar with things that we're using every single day that we don't think about, that are part of our familiar reality, but they started out as a military application. You know, when you think about the moon landing, you know, that seems like a, you know, outside of the egoic patriotism of a country, that we were the first to land on the moon, or, you know, it seems pretty useless in any other way, unless you understand that the technology is used every single day in our lives. Computer microchips, cordless tools. I read somewhere about transparent brackets used in dentistry come from stuff that was done for the moon landing. I mean, you know, it's, so I think there's always
Velcro is my favorite.
Was that?
Velcro is my favorite.
Velcro, there you go, right? I mean, you know, there's so many of these things, right, that just become part of that, that I think, you know, it's a big, big conversation. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, I really want to ask you and discover with you more about why you even got into this field, when you got into it, because maybe it was a different world entirely at that time. Let's take a little break. And I just want to let you know that this episode of Leadership and Loyalty is brought to you in part by our other podcast, Curiosity Bites. Curiosity Bites is the answer to the question, how can we bring people together who completely disagree? This is exactly what your mind, soul, and heart have been craving. It's a chance to sit down and sit in on some real and often intense conversations about some of the world's most interesting people, including astronauts, neuroscientists, philosophers, holy men, quantum physicists, skeptics, entrepreneurs, entertainers, and even some folks that you might have thought were a-holes, but are actually truly fascinating. Simply go to dovebaron.com, that's dovebaron.com, and find out how you can sink your teeth into an episode of Curiosity Bites. Welcome back. I'm here with my guest. I want to make sure you say it this time, because we want to make sure you get it right. Yeah, because let's do that. With?
Ryan Gariepy.
Ryan Gariepy. Okay. So as I said, I saw Ryan speak at Singularity University in 2019. He's the co-founder of Clearpath Robotics. And we've been discussing the ethics of military robots. Now let's sort of bring it back to you. What got you in there? What got you interested in this subject? Why did you get into this field?
I mean, it really is as simple as robots are cool, right? Just building something. Good. Yeah, it really is like building something that seems to have a little bit of agency on its own is, I mean, that's not the way I would have thought of it when I was, you know, 16 or 17 or whenever I was applying to university, but it's just a really interesting thing. It's, you know, you're programming something, you're making something, and all of a sudden it just goes off on its own. That's really, well, I mean, ideally you press go first, but it's just a really interesting thing. And then at the time there was it wasn't actually that popular. It wasn't a really big field outside of, you know, some military technology, some other, you know, research and development efforts. And when I was finishing up school, I worked for a startup company called Kiva Systems, which people now know as Amazon Robotics. I worked for a drone company called Arion, which was now recently bought by FLIR. But all of these things, all of these companies had the same problem, which was that they had really great ideas for what to do with robots, but really couldn't figure out what to do with them, or really couldn't figure out how to get them going. And so we said, myself and the co-founders of Clearpath said that we'd try our hand at helping some of these companies out. And what we really weren't foreseeing is that over the next decade, it was going to be a trillion-dollar industry with self-driving cars being on the lips of every media pundit and a drone under every Christmas tree. We didn't really anticipate that. We got into it well before there was a lot of that activity.
Were you a kid with one of those robot building kits that I'm not trying to remember what they were called, but I remember seeing those
The Lego ones?
Well, they weren't just Lego. They were I'm trying to think what the name of the kit was, but it was a kit, and you put it all together, and you little drivers in there, you made these little robots.
I think I had some, like, I believe it was Capsella was one, and then Meccano was another. I think Meccano I had some of those
sets,
kits,
but yeah, Meccano sets.
Nothing really big, like nothing really extensive. I know kids now, there's all these opportunities of, FIRST Robotics and Vex Robotics being the two leading ones. There's a lot of opportunity to get involved here. But at the time that myself and the Clearpath co-founders were going through, there was really wasn't as much to really wasn't as much at all. We had to just kind of apply to university and hope we liked it.
So let's make the distinction, because it's easy to put the two things together, and I think they go together, but I think you're also going to make a distinction for us so that people can understand the distinction between AI and robotics, right? Because they intercede with each other, but they are different focuses, right?
Yeah.
So walk us through a bit of understanding on that, the difference between the two and how they come together.
And so first a caveat to anyone who's watching this, who's more of the academic bent, that I'm going to use the popular culture bent. So please don't send me angry messages after the fact.
No, but I'll say that language that somebody who's completely naive about this.
Yeah.
Understands.
One of my professional colleagues out at McGill, he's fond of saying that AI is actually a subset of robotics, that the entire AI field is within robotics, because to build a robot, you need to be able to give it some degree of agency, which in some ways is a lot of what AI is to build an artificial, artificial piece of software that has some degree of agency. And then on top of that, robotics has many other challenges around mobility and control and sensing and all of these different aspects. But you can look at AI as just that piece of software that's living in a box, right? It's given some kind of clean input, camera data, what have you, and it's got a very easy way of outputting information from that, right? It's given information about, what you viewed, what websites you viewed, and it's deciding to serve you ads of a certain kind. It's giving you camera data, and it's deciding what's a cat, what's a dog, what's a table, what's a chair. Whereas robotics goes from there, and it really talks about how you can build something that can sense, think, and act, outside of its own envelope, outside of its own body. Mm-hmm. So you can have, a lot of the functions that make up a robot are arguably in a modern dishwasher or a modern clothes dryer. Right? There's a lot of intelligence there, but they're not really affecting the world. However, a Roomba, for example, that's, clearly a robot.
Right. Because these lines are all sort of blurring as we move further forward. The Internet of Things, where your fridge notifies your phone that you're out of milk, if you put it in the right place where the milk goes. That it can recognize that. That's AI, but that essentially means that the fridge is some kind of robotics. Is that, would that be a fair comment?
Well, that's why people have really tried to focus on that definition, including how the envelope or the body, so to speak, that when it's only the fridge acting within the fridge, you know, it's not really a robot.
Right.
But there's actually a lot of interesting work going on to try to better define what it is and what it isn't. But honestly, it's been a challenge that's existed for, I think, upwards of 50 years. Like, what is a robot? What isn't? And there's a famous quote saying that, you know, I don't know what a robot is, but I'll know it when I see it. But you know, really, really, at least in the field, we don't really tend to debate it as much. I mean, our company, when we look at what we do, we build robots, but we also, you know, we're process designers, we're material handling experts, we're researchers. All of these things are, you can be more than one thing at once, right? So we don't really fuss too much on what the definition of a robot is. We just wait for our customers to come ask for them.
Right. So, you know, when we think about that kind of interface of robotics and technology in the context of AI, the most common conversation is usually around things like self-driving cars and self-driving trucks. Do you see that as is that where we're really going? Because, or do you see that we really need to be focused on, I mean, is that just the cool thing as opposed to the actual use?
I mean, I think self-driving cars and self-driving trucks are certainly cool and useful. However, I do think that the amount of hype and money and time that's been invested in particularly self-driving cars is a little bit, is both inefficient and a little bit outside of the value that they bring or that they can bring. I think that something like autonomous material movement in a warehouse or factory and, you know, autonomous farming, autonomous construction, all of these things are both easier because you've got a constrained environment. You don't have to worry about school kids running around your factory. You don't have to worry about a thunderstorm in your warehouse. And on top of that, they're also generally more valuable work, right? You can, again, to call back to the situation we're in right now, we still need to make food.
Right.
You're telling everyone, don't go out. But on the other hand, the food still needs to be made. The buildings still need to get repaired. Mm-hmm. And the medicine still needs to get to people. So that's why I think it's both inefficient to make that investment now, and also the value estimation is a little off. But on the other hand, I mean, it's hype.
Sure.
But ideally, what we would have done is we would have solved this supply chain problem, we would have solved this construction and farming problem, and then from there, building your self-driving car on top of that will be easy.
Right. So if we move forward in time right now, having gone through the COVID-19 2020 pandemic, and now we are, let's pretend that human beings learn something from their past. let's be optimistic.
And it sticks.
And it sticks, yeah. I mean, we will learn, but will it stick? That's a much better point. So let's pretend that we learn and it sticks. And we go, okay. And another one's coming and it's 10 years from now. Because there have been, I mean, people don't, of course, people have very short memories. We had SARS. We had, you know, the Ebola. We've had lots of these kinds of things. This is just the biggest one that's global. So there's another one coming in 10 years. Where would you hope we are in the context of robotics and artificial intelligence so that this doesn't shut down the world?
Yeah, well, I mean, I can tell you in a few areas where I know we can be if we choose to. And I think if we talk about, I'll focus more on manufacturing and warehousing because that's where I've been spending a lot of my time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also a fairly critical piece of infrastructure right now that I think we'll need, first, fundamentally, we'll need a lot less people in these operations, which is obviously makes them less sensitive. But also if in the age of social distancing, it means that people are no longer literally working side by side. So it makes them safer. Mm-hmm. I think that's something which is quite possible. I think similar on areas like critical infrastructure monitoring, critical infrastructure maintenance. I have a relative of mine who works in the power industry, and he's still got to go into the office, the office being a power plant, but the management can work from home. So let's see what we can do to make that a little bit more remote monitorable, for lack of a better term. I think that's all easily possible. I think there's also, now there's interesting societal questions around what's good or what's bad. For instance, I think we talked a little bit about basic income, like what happens to all those people if we do decide coming out of this crisis that we really want fewer people in the critical supply chain, well, what happens? And there's another question that people are starting to talk about around privacy, for example. You know, in 10 years, I think it'll be maybe we won't yet have self-driving cars on the street, but on the other hand, robots that are fully safe to operate in public spaces will be, you know, very possible. And do you want to mount them with thermal cameras to look for fevers? Well, that will be possible, but is it right? And I think those are questions that we as society need to, you know, really need to ask ourselves.
Yeah, I think that we are on the brink of many changes, as I've said, but I think that one of the great dilemmas is what human beings are willing to do because of fear. And I think that we are, you know, if this was a political conversation, a political, moral, ethical conversation, the conversation would be, what rights are you willing to give up in order to stay safe? I.e., a simple question is, if there is a vaccine comes out and it's made globally mandatory that you have it or you can't travel, that's a restriction on your freedoms. That's a moral issue that many people would take very seriously and go, no, thank you. Mm-hmm. Right? But they want the freedom to travel, but you can't go through the airport if you haven't had your COVID-19 vaccination. It's, you know, and that for me is just one simple understanding of how easy it is to let our rights slip away in the name of quote unquote safety. But that, you know, that bar goes either side of that. Safety, yes, in health, but in privacy, no. So it's a very interesting time in the context of that.
Yeah, and I mean, there's certainly other areas, like I prefer to think on, and I mean, we've never really been a company to build, you know, surveillance gear or any of that sort, because there are those difficult challenges that we think society as a whole needs to work through. And as a startup company, you don't really have the patience for society to work through those challenges while you're out there. You've got to build things, ideally for the good of most. But on the other hand, there are still some areas where we see that there may be other options that in 10 years will be easier. I mean, right now we're talking about what degree of border shutdown is possible. Well, we know that a robot truck driver that there are challenges navigating trucks on city streets, but on the other hand, freeways are relatively easy.
Yes.
Based on all the progress that many companies and researchers have done over the last 10 years. So 10 years from now, I can anticipate that we'll have trucks on freeways. And if we look at that in the view of a pandemic, then that means that the truck driver doesn't need to cross the border.
Right.
The goods can, the truck driver doesn't have to, right? So that certainly changes things. But again, we get back to this fundamental problem. Like let's even ignore the cause of it. Let's just say that society as a whole has decided for one reason or other that rhymes with COVID-19, that it's decided to accelerate the rate of displacing jobs with machines. Mm-hmm. And in the short term, we do have a need for people to do more skilled labor. Like there's other skilled labor that doesn't require moving boxes around that people can do work from home. But in the long term, it's not that clear.
Right. And one of the things you say that I think is really interesting in that context, because as I said, there's been a lot, I mean, it's the most common, I think the most common conversation about AI and robotics is that of self-driving cars, etc. But you talk a lot about building robots for good rather than for first world convenience. Talk to us about that, because I think that's something that people need to get. Because when we think about driving cars, that's $100,000 plus for most people, right?
And it's, I mean, I don't know how much of your viewers or yourself have had either experience working in you know, we'll just say those dull, dirty, dangerous jobs. Like, I'm not sure if you've had personal experience doing that. But I'd suspect that many have. And what sometimes people forget is that there are people, I think the number is something like 1 in 7 of the modern workforce is stuck working a job where it's physically hard on them. You know, they can't choose their breaks. They're possibly working night shifts, day shifts, swing shifts. It's hard on them. It's hard on their families. Yeah. And on one hand, there's the benefit, like on the pure, like just benefit to society, there's a clear benefit there. And frankly, also from the pragmatic sense, people work those, or we get people to work those hours because it's a needed job, right? There's a value there. And a self-driving car, like there's been multiple studies, both formal and also, I mean, if you look at how much people will pay for the Tesla self-driving vehicle capability, or whatever they're calling it these days, the pre-order, that's an informal study on what people are willing to pay for self-driving vehicle functionality. And the answer is not much.
Right.
But what companies are willing to pay for a forklift driver on 3 shifts, the answer is a lot. Yeah, and there's good reason for that, right?
Yeah. That's a very good point. And one of the things you say is that humility and ego are both needed to build a sustainable business. Tell us what you mean by that, because that in and of itself is a very interesting thing to say.
Yeah, I think people, especially, you know, I'm gonna say in the age of sound bites, but I'm sure even, you know, if we translated it, Aristotle or Plato might have had things to say about sound bites in the time that they lived. But it's in the age of, we'll just say, you know, podcasts and Medium posts and what have you, it's really easy for people to polarize things like leadership.
Yes.
You know, everyone should do 100% what they say they should do. And if they don't, you should fire them. Or, you know, servant leadership, you must always be the servant. Or you must show no ego whatsoever. But I think one of the things that I personally believe it's about what's needed at any given time. You know, put yourself in the shoes of the people who you're conversing with, who you're speaking to. You know, ask yourself what you're trying to accomplish, because it takes on one hand it takes a certain amount of ego to just sit here and talk with you. Right. To believe personally that I have something to contribute to your listeners, that takes some ego. But on the other hand, that's not the way that you can't just approach everyone at your office as if you're the best person around. But I think fundamentally the way to succeed though, is to have some degree of self-reflection, to know what you're good at, what you're not, to know what you bring to the table, for a given table, right? Is it the virtual table that we're sitting around, or is it, the physical or now virtual table that I sit around at the office, right? What am I bringing to that table? And I think self-reflection helps inform that.
Do you know, one of the things for me, and it's interesting because you brought up self-reflection, and for me, the work that we do with companies, with individuals, you know, I have said for years that I believe the new bottom line is self-knowledge and self-actualization in order to be a great leader. And that means that you know when to step up and you know when to step back, as you were just saying. But I will say this, there's a term that I think is held negatively, but I think it's an interesting term because I've never met a leader, a good leader at least, who wasn't obsessed about something. You know, we can see obsession as a negative term. I don't see it that way, but we can. What are you obsessed with?
I mean, this one, I'm sure the answers are all cliche, but the one that comes, the word that comes first and foremost to mind is partnership. It's saying that, I mean, we're Canada's largest robotics company, possibly North America's largest robotics company at this point. And even we can't accomplish everything we want to accomplish, right? There's so much out in the world that we can help with. But first, a lot of other companies have realized different facets of the same challenge. They've staffed, they've built teams in different ways. They have different cultures. And that's something that I'm always looking for is who can I partner with within either within our company, who can we bring together to solve these problems, or without the company or outside the company, sorry. I think recently, about a month ago, we announced a partnership with Boston Dynamics, for example, because they have certain bits of technology and we have certain bits of technology and we have certain products and they have certain products and they complement each other. Yes. And so why spend all this time building that when they've done all the work? And really the goal is to see that these products make as much of an impact as we possibly can.
You know, it's fascinating to me that when people look at AI and robotics, they see the decline of humanity. And by that, I don't mean as in like, you know, the robot armies are coming to kill us all. What I mean is that they actually think that they can almost abdicate their humanity. This is my opinion. It's not the truth. My opinion is that we need far greater humanity and need greater levels of connection to what really matters at a human level. You know, you are right there in that world of robot AI, you know, like I said, largest robotics company in Canada, maybe in North America. What's your thoughts on that? Do you think it's going away, or do you think we need to get a hell of a lot better at our own humanity?
No. I certainly agree with that point. I certainly agree with that point because we need to more and more as this technology as robotics technology and AI technology expand, it's important to still have perspective on what can and can't be done with it. And that's how we got into the whole autonomous weapon systems debate in the first place. Yep. But even to talk to one of the first things we chatted about, which is elder care.
Yes.
Like if you had to pick one choice where it's either the robot takes care of my aging parents and I work night shifts at a factory, or the robot works night shifts at a factory and I take care of my aging parents, there's the, you know, what are you likely to be better at? And, right. You know, where is the humanity? And I think that's also where some choices reside as well. And I think there's been some recent op-eds published around this, like, no, the robots won't save us all, et cetera. And I can say that I'm not sure who they're listening to, because I don't think any roboticists are saying the robots will save them all, but here we are.
Well, but it is a nice attention grabber.
Yeah.
Before we finish up, I would really like to know the context of this show, you know, so our listeners, our viewers, are leaders. They're leaders in many different ways. They, you know, so most often C-suite leaders in Fortune 500 organizations, CEOs, etc. But they're also high-level entrepreneurs and people who are committed to self-leadership as well. In the context of that, I would really love for you to give us some practical guidance as we move into this, hopefully moving into embracing robotics in a very different way. And how can we do better with it practically as leaders?
That's quite the challenge. I think, yeah. first and foremost, if we're just talking about, you know, tips about robots in general, that it's really about where you already understand the process, right? Where you already know things are getting done, where you don't need creativity. You know, no matter how many cool videos you see out there about, you know, robots doing backflips or videos being labeled or, you know, deep fakes or what have you, there's really no creativity there yet. So really, if you're looking to apply robotics, just like any other, we'll just say traditional software automation tools, it's really about where are the processes are really already well understood. Like, where can you explain this? You know, could you explain this to a four-year-old? Because robots are really literal. Like, just fundamentally, they're programmed in a very clear way. They're very deterministic. They're very literal. So, you know, where has the creativity already been removed from the work? And let's put the robots there, because not only is it more likely to succeed for your business, it's also going to be better for your team, right? If you've already stripped creativity out of the task, then that person they're probably first not wanting, they're not really enjoying it. It's not a really mentally, you know, stimulating thing for them to do. And it's also, it's pretty low value for the fact that you're paying a human to sit there. So that's a general good guidance on that. And I think you've seen some recent, or not, you know, in the last few years, you've seen news like Elon Musk deciding to automate everything in his Tesla factories and then stepping back, because it turns out that humans are really creative. And when you're changing the face of how cars are built fundamentally, as he is, you need to not try to, you need that kind of creativity everywhere from the C-suite of your company all the way down to the people building the cars. And I think that's a very recent modern example of making that mistake.
And you are building robots that literally build cars and other machinery and other products. That's part of what you do.
Yeah. Right? Our stuff, it, you know, transport car parts, food, medical equipment, all sorts of things these days.
Yeah. It's a fascinating, fascinating world, which I know you're at the cutting edge of, and we are really grateful and honored that you were here to share this with us today, Ryan, and I really appreciate it. I would love for you to tell our viewers, our listeners, where they can find out more about you, what it is you do, what your company does, and if there's things you want them to know.
Yeah, that sounds great. I mean, I can be reached at ryan@clearpath.ai or on LinkedIn. On the company divisions for our research robotics division is clearpathrobotics.com. And then for industrial systems and self-driving vehicles for factories and warehouses, that's automotors.com. That's O-T-T-O motors.com.
O-T-O.
O-T-O. O-T-T-O.
O-T-T-O.
There are two T's.
Okay. Yes. Thank you for that. It was awesome. Listen, this is a fascinating conversation. I'm really grateful for you being here with us and taking the time out. I know you weren't in the office because nobody... But at the same time, we're all still, I put a thing out on social media and I asked a question. I said, I'm just curious, are you working more, less, or about the same? And you know what the majority of answers were?
Probably more.
Way more. So, you know, everybody seems to think that everybody's sitting at home watching Netflix, and that's probably true. But it's interesting to me that most people I'm talking to are actually doing way more work. So thank you for taking the time out to be with us.
No problem at all.
And I hope you stay with us to the end. And for you, dear listener, you can chat and hang out with other conscious leaders and chat about this episode or any past episodes by going to looking Facebook or LinkedIn for our groups, and you can see the Leadership and Loyalty podcast. And there you can chat about what we've been talking about today, because that's a fascinating subject. And it doesn't matter how successful you are. If your employees and your customers don't understand what gives your company meaning, you're only working at a fraction of your true capability. To find out how you can hire me, Dov Barron, as a speaker or leader, strategist for your organization, come talk to us at dovbarron.com. Because unified meaning is, or as we call it, finding your dragon fire, is the one single monolithic difference between mediocrity and greatness for all individuals and companies. I want to thank you for sharing the show with everybody you know. Till next time, stay curious, my friends. Stay curious about the future of robotics and how we all need to just open up a little bit and embrace them, because this is about taking away the dull and the dangerous and the, what was the other one? Dull, dangerous,
and the dirty.
And the dirty jobs away from all of us, so we can live with a lot more dignity. I'm Dov Barron, and I'm here to assist you tapping into your dragon fire to reach that next level of clarity, focus, purpose, and profit in your business, your life, and your leadership impact.